In the name of God, Holy Eternal Majesty, Holy Incarnate Word, and Holy Abiding Presence. Amen. Some of you may know the story. In 1839, Portuguese slave traders abducted a group of Africans from the Mende people near present-day Sierra Leone. They were taken across the Atlantic to Havana, Cuba. During the crossing, nearly one-third of the captives died from malnutrition, beatings, and disease. In Havana, 53 were sold to plantation owners and placed on a schooner called La Amistad. Once out at sea, the captives took over the ship. They ended up on the shores of New York, where they were apprehended and taken to New Haven, Connecticut. New York had made slavery illegal, but Connecticut had not. A complicated legal proceeding ensued. One side argued that the captives should be sent back to Cuba because this was a Spanish problem. The other side argued that the Africans had been illegally captured and therefore should be set free. The Africans argued that they were not property to be bought and sold. They were human beings. They had been illegally captured and held. Well, the court decided in favor of the Africans, saying that they were indeed free human beings, and the government was ordered to pay for their return to Africa. But the case was appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court. Former President John Quincy Adams defended the Africans, citing the Declaration of Independence and principles of U.S. law that protect individual rights. On March 9, 1841, the court ruled that the Africans could finally go home. But the funds were held up. So a group of abolitionists formed the Amistad Committee. They raised enough money to pay for the Africans to return home about a year later. So why do we in the United Church of Christ observe Amistad Sunday? When the Africans were being held in Connecticut, a group of Congregationalists reached out to them and raised financial support to feed them and clothe them. They also helped with their legal aid. And more than a century later, the Congregationalists joined with other denominations to form the United Church of Christ. Those early Congregationalists were at the center of the abolitionist movement. The original Amistad Committee continued to meet after the Amistad captives were freed. It eventually became the American Missionary Association, the first anti-slavery missionary organization in the United States. That association continues to this day. It's part of the United Church of Christ under the United Church Board of Homeland Ministries. A replica of La Amistad was built and launched at the Mystic Seaport Museum Shipyard in 2000. It serves as a floating classroom, helping call attention to issues of slavery, freedom, cooperation, leadership, equality, and human dignity. It calls attention to issues of racism, bigotry, greed, injustice, and intolerance. The former UCC conference minister in Connecticut, Davida Foy Crabtree, said of the freedom schooner Amistad, "It was the Congregationalists who stepped forward to save the captives. To tell that story is a story of African Americans and European Americans collaborating to end slavery and to look forward and work on racism today." She said that the story of La Amistad reminds us in the United Church of Christ of our spiritual heritage in the anti-slavery movement and our long-standing commitment to justice for all people. By the way, La Amistad is Spanish for friendship, which is perhaps both ironic and a fitting encapsulation of its history. In our gospel reading for today, we hear about Jesus cleansing the temple. All four gospels tell this story, each in slightly different ways. Matthew, Mark, and Luke place it toward the end of their narrative, following Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday. In their accounts, the cleansing of the temple is the provocative act that prompts the religious authorities in the capital city to have Jesus arrested, put on trial, and put to death. In John's account, the cleansing of the temple occurs at the very beginning of Jesus' public ministry on earth, in chapter 2. In some ways, John heightens the provocation of Jesus' actions. It is Passover, the week-long festival that celebrates the story of God leading the Israelite people out of slavery in Egypt. In the book of Exodus, we read that God liberated the people from bondage under Pharaoh and then established a covenant relationship with them, showing them how they should live together as a community. When Jesus arrives at the temple during Passover, he sees that something has gone terribly wrong. Inside the temple, people are selling animals and changing money. It was a way of making sure that the animals being sacrificed were unblemished. And one could not give coins bearing the image of Caesar for a temple offering. So people could exchange their coins for temple coins that did not have a graven image. These practices were intended for the benefit of those who came to the temple to worship. But something was wrong. Perhaps it was that the buying and selling had been brought into the temple itself, into an area called the Court of the Gentiles. And perhaps, as the other gospels suggest, the buying and selling had become exploitative, turning the temple into a den of robbers. It appears that what Jesus saw in the temple made him quite angry. John says that he made a whip of cords and he drove all of them out of the temple along with all of the animals. He overturned the tables of the money changers spilling coins all over the floor. In doing so, Jesus is acting in the tradition of the Old Testament prophets who spoke out against the abuses of the temple, the corruption of temple worship, and putting ritual purity in place of concern for the poor, the disadvantaged, the handicapped, the aged, those who are easily shoved to the margins. And the prophets said that those on the so-called margins should be regarded as the center of our attention. The prophets had called for honesty in action, deeds of compassion, and a commitment to justice. Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann says that the prophets saw justice as sorting out what belongs to whom and giving it back to them. It is important to understand that Jesus was not attacking the temple. He was not attacking Jews or Jewish religion. He himself was an observant Jew. He worshiped in synagogues and in the temple with other Jews. He once said that he had not come to abolish the law, that is the Torah, or the prophets, but instead had come to fulfill them. When Jesus chases the money changers and the livestock sellers out of the temple, he intends to show in a vivid and provocative way how the worship of God had gone astray. He wants to teach us something about true worship and devotion to God. We might think of the church reformers in the 16th century, Martin Luther and John Calvin and others. They had a motto in Latin, Ecclesia reformata semper reformanda secundum verbum Dei. The church reformed, always to be reformed by the word of God. First Congregational Church comes out of that tradition of Reformation. We cannot claim to have arrived at any kind of perfection or wholeness. There have certainly been missteps along our way. We must be open to the future into which God is calling us in this time and in this place. We are part of an ongoing process of reformation, being reformed in ways that may surprise us, in ways that we may find strange. But it isn't that we are simply reforming ourselves. Instead, we say that we are being reformed. We are being reformed by Jesus, who is the Word of God. You may have noticed that before we read Scripture, we often say, "Listen for the Word of God." What Jesus shows us in the cleansing of the temple is that it is God who judges us, reforms us, and renews the worshiping community. So, as Congregationalists and as a Church of the United Church of Christ, we look at our historic heritage and we look at our current practices, and we ask together as a church, who is God calling us to become? Not an easy question, but one that we would do well to ask with careful discernment and with prayer. Amen, and thanks be to God.